Greetings, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to the Azure Seas of Nita. I am der Heizmeister, and this is episode 4 of the Quest for Nita campaign. The second try. Yeah. Now then, I have done a lot of things between the last and this episode. First and foremost, the one that you see here. This is the Brigantia Battlecruiser, built upon the whole design of the Constantia Battlecruiser, and this will be the flagship of Task Force Jupiter. Now then, time for a little analysis. The Brigantia is equipped with four of these double-barreled 400mm turrets. They fire rail-assisted HESH projectiles. It is also equipped with 8 missile silos here in the back, firing infrared-guided EMP missiles, as well as a combined Seabiss anti-aircraft system, some minor AA armament in the form of these simple weapons, and last but not least, a quad-barreled kinetic cannon in the back, and also some torpedo launchers. And what I would like to emphasize, laser warners. This battlecruiser is designed to fight against lightning hoods, to some extent at least, and is absolutely covered in smoke dispensers. Now then, this is the situation on the map. I have so far captured a lot of territory from the Deepwater Guard and solidified my positions on the border next to the lightning hoods. And we can now see that the Steel Striders, as well as the Twin Guard, are making advances into Lightning Hood territory. They have severely crippled the Lightning Hood's defenses here. This Candela, for example, is only at 64%, as well as this Eclipse. They are both heading back to repairs, I assume. And they have set up a little outpost here, which is trying to repair a Candela. Yeah, this is going to be dangerous if I want to engage this area here. However, I have now decided that the best course of action is to not attack the Onyx Watch for now, but rather straight attack the Lightning Hoods. As I can see, the headquarters of the Lightning Hoods, here the Quartzstone Fortress, is only 3 terrain tiles away from my border. And I will now plan to execute a decapitation strike. I will rally my forces here and then push straight through this Lightning Hoods territory to take out their headquarters and denying them the means of producing more units. At least this is the plan. And I do hope from some support from the Steel Striders at Twin Guard to keep the Lightning Hoods busy in the north, so that they don't, get the idea of taking me out here. Yeah, this is going to be a little bit finicky, but I guess it could work. Other than that, I've established a second outpost here with a small dockyard, to support the forces that are stationed here in the east. And I can see that my HQ, the base zone, has already amassed a substantial amount of resources, and I'm able to build another unit. So, the unit that I'm going to construct next here at the base zone will be the heavy cruiser SMS Arcrux. And this is a well-balanced cruiser, more geared towards engaging faster and more nimble opponents, as it has some rail-assisted weaponry as well as a lot of anti-aircraft armament. I think this is perfect for the Lightning Hoods. So, we have an Ampere, a Flash, and not much else. It's about a Thunderbird. Yeah. A Thunderbird. This could be very difficult if I'm not careful. However, before I ultimately engage the Lightning Hoods, I have to make some adjustments to Task Force Jupiter first. Yeah, it seems that I have to get rid of some units. Some units will be phased out as they will most likely not be suitable to fight against the lightning hordes. Yeah, I do have a lot here that have done a great deal of work against the Twin Guard. Not Twin Guard, the Water Guard, yeah, the other guard. This means war.
Receiving.
So, how should I put this? Yeah, relationships, the Lightning Hoods. They are currently on the brink of war. My faction, which means, come and get it.
Receiving.
Alright, into that territory we go. Task Force Jupiter, full steam ahead. What could possibly go wrong? Oh, by the way, I completely forgot to mention that I'm starting to build the first of my airships, starting with the Vega Aero Torpedo Boat. And here we have the first customer, the Thunderbird, coming to get a healthy portion of firepower. And quite eager as well, coming at 228 meters per second. That is fast. Let's introduce ourselves to the Lightning Hoods then. Yep, there we go. Should I take the Polaris into combat? No, not yet. I will take the Brigantia and maybe increase the battle size to 50k. We'll see about that. There we go. I mean, yeah, there we go. Oh, right. I need to increase the game speed a little. What? All weapons are active, and the Thunderbird is something I would like to see before I blow it up. Yeah, the Thunderbirds are a go, apparently. What a nice looking unit. This truly deserves the name Thunderbird. Well, looks like a bird, apparently. Okay, shame about blowing it up. Oh, by the way, here, if you can see it, I hope that the cannons are not too loud, this is the alternating fire pattern that I've set up on this quad cannon, using the new synchronization options. And speaking of new, Front Adepts has been released, officially been released yesterday. Version 1.0 is the one I'm currently playing in. Yeah. Some visual improvements have been made, some rebalances to steam engines, and for some reason the Thunderbird is not firing its laser cannon, I assume. This is the one hanging on the belly there, the laser cannon. What is happening? Have I taken out some important components? I do hope so. I do hope so indeed. But yeah, alternating fire pattern on this kinetic cannon made with synchronization. If you want to, I can show how I did it in the beginning of the next episode. But it isn't that hard, to be honest. Well then. How's the Thunderbird doing? Completely missed. Against the Lightning Hoods, these rail-assisted cannons are fairly potent, and they should hit their faster units more reliably. So... oh, looks like this is the anti-aircraft cannon opening up. And there's the Jackhammer Gatling, built by Ion Mark III, which I've altered a little bit and then put on this battlecruiser and many other ships. This one is perfect for intercepting cram shells and missiles. It does struggle a little bit with very large missiles, but it's not meant to be the ultimate tool in intercepting missiles. It should work in combination with decoys and interceptors, as well as the lamps. Oh, looks like the Thunderbird has... Yep, has landed in the water. Well, this means I can then use the torpedoes to destroy this one. Speaking of torpedoes, here they are with their new visual effects added in the final release version of From the Depths. And it looks like that's it for the Thunderbird. It's a shame that it hasn't opened up with its laser, so I could have shown the excessive smoke screen of the Brigantia. The Brigantia has shields as well, though they are only at strength 3, I assume. I believe I've set it up to be at strength 3. So yeah, the first victim of the campaign against Lightning Hoods, the Thunderbird.
Moving now.
Halt. For a second, yes, please get blockaded, Lionfish. You are now my sacrificial Lionfish for now, not Lamp. I fear that the Twin Guard and the Steel Striders will make great progress here in the north and basically capture all this terrain before I'm able to solidify my position here in the south, which means I have to act quickly if I want to have any piece of Lightning Hood territory and their resource zones as well. Are those... Oh yeah. Those torpedo boats are finally finished. Okay, to the front lines with you. I could use the air support. But for now, let's engage two more Thunderbirds. And this time...
Receiving.
I will be on the Brigantia, as usual, and I will bring in another unit. This unit should provide a lot of support against those Thunderbirds. I want to have Razul's Murray with me in the fight. 45, there we go. Its guided missiles are perfect for disabling other enemy units, so that my larger damage dealers can have an easier job at taking them down. So, this is the Murray, by the way. This little boat here alone can take on a Crossbones, you know, the big ship from the Water Guard, and to some extent even a Bulwark. I'm being completely serious right now. There we go. Missiles have hit. Projectiles... not so much. A lot of those projectiles are still missing. And the Thunderbird isn't activating their lasers. Looks like I've taken out something critical right off the bat here. Very early on, it seems that the Thunderbird has lost some critical components. So, an unfortunate end for the Thunderbird. He is a little bit, wet now. He has found a resting place in the waters. So, a perfect target for torpedoes, both from the Brigantia as well as from the Murray. The Murray does have remote-controlled... what are they called? Heat? Yeah, I think they are heat torpedoes. So particularly dangerous at taking out components that are mounted below the waterline and near the bottom of the hull. The second Thunderbird. Still not using its laser for some reason. Huh. Anyway, I would shoot this one down as well. A missile silo, salvo, fired from the missile silos of the Murray, has disabled one engine of the Thunderbird. It's now spiraling ever closer to my forces. And there we go. Engine on the wing disabled. And I think that's it. Looks like it's losing altitude rather quickly. Yep. Soon it'll be a perfect target for the torpedoes. Speaking of which, have they been fired yet? No, not yet. There we go. Main cannon's finally opening up. It's still flying, I wanted to say, but now, as I said it, it's already touching the surface of the water, and yeah, I think that's it. A very graceful landing for such a very graceful aircraft, and unfortunate though that it didn't fire back. I was so eager to test the smoke dispensers of the Brigantia. Anyway, I think that's it. Let's have a look inside. Not much left there. Oh no, I'm mistaken, the AI is still alive. But yeah. Torpedoes? Yep, torpedoes. Oh wait, it's resting on the bottom of the sea. I think the seafloor. what a shame. Anyway, that's it, and I can now push further into Lightning Lord's territory. My goal is still to eliminate the headquarters rather quickly, so that the Lightning Lords will be unable to build any other units. Now then, despawn already, and there we go. Capturing in progress, that's what I want to see. Actually, 20,000 resources. That would be a waste to just leave lying there. Fortunately for me, however, those two Vega torpedo boats will be able to pick those up. So yeah. Oh, listening. Is that a moving Candela? One of the more annoying units from the Lightning Hoods. It has a well-armored laser, which is quite strong, actually. It is fast and oftentimes very unpredictable. Not threatening, just annoying. Okay. Yeah, just as I thought. As soon as the Lightning Hood's presence has been dealt with here in the north, the Steel Striders as well as the Twin Guard are moving into their territory, here into the Lightning Hood's territory, and are starting to capture it. This could put a wrench in my plans, and my plans are to capture all of the Lightning Hood's territory, or at least everything until here. So I might want to use my aircraft to capture a little bit more. But first,
moving out.
I'm having that.
Moving out.
Okay. Oh, hello, Candela. Let's see. 74%. Yeah.
Receiving. Moving now.
How to deal with this one? Well, if you're approaching me, oh, not this one, from the other side of this island, then I don't mind. Just a heads up though, expect some lag to happen. The Candela is about to ram the island, which I'm not complaining, but yeah. And here we go. So, here's the Candela. It has taken some damage. It is, by the way, a 1 million resource unit. Very expensive. Very, very potent laser in this one. And also very annoying to deal with. Well, unless you're using submarines and particle accelerator cannons. That would be the best way to fight this unit. Go. Oh yeah, laser is active. Whoops. And here's the lag. I will most likely skip this sequence, at least until the candela has been destroyed. Oh, wait. We may be able to see the smoke dispensers on the Brigantia now. Yep, smoking up quite nicely. And the candela is airborne. Aha, I knew it wouldn't hold a candle to my forces. Yep, sorry, that was a terrible pun. I apologize. Yeah, I think this is it. An already damaged candela and smoke as well as shields. Yep, that's it. Thank you for the resources though, dear Lightning Hoods. I appreciate the fuel for my war machine. Wow, the lag is getting unbearable. Let me just pause the game here and let the candela despawn properly. Battle finished. Nice. Okay then. Noisy steam engine. Yeah. So
receiving, moving now.
Back to capturing, I guess. Finally. I just needed a reason to deploy this one. And the Lionfish microsub as well.
Receiving.
Because why not? Okay then. Against a flash. Carrier has been deployed. And vector fighters are on their way. And another one. By the way, I do plan to deploy my larger carrier, the one that I've made a video series while building it. I made a video series of the construction of this one. And there is the flash. Quite a speedy little unit. Looks like some of these ground effect vehicles. Although it's... yeah, it's... held above the water by hydrofoils. And my fighters cannot catch up to it. Or can they? Oh, good hit. Yeah, they are not the fastest little fighters, but they are versatile and those missiles should be able to hit this one. Yeah. Oh, particle. Particle cannon, but unfortunately too late. This one has already despawned.
Receiving.
Nice. So, what do we have here? An Ampere and an Angstrom. Wait. Oh, it's one of those. Oh no. Yeah, it's candela, light. Basically.
Moving now.
Oh boy. Well, so much for my push into Lightning Hood's territory and executing a decapitation strike. I am being threatened by an Angstrom. 500,000 plus resources. Nothing to scoff at. Lionfish. Yes, you as well.
Listening.
Okay then, I had to basically recall the Vega torpedo boat in a short order because there was a fuse coming in and I do not have the means to deal with this one. At least the Vega cannot deal with the fuse. The Vega is only to be used against larger targets. Anyway, here we go. Fight against the Angstrom. Go, come on, deploy everything, fire everything. Shields up, weapons online, and engage. Yeah, there we go. It's one of those speedy hydrofoil doom laser things. And the Brigantia is smoked up quite nicely. It does hamper the lamp's effectiveness, though. You know, there's a drawback to all this smoke. But at least the laser doesn't have that much strength now. more smoke. Yes. Nah. Did I overdo it? I know that smoke. Don't you dare. You did not clip the Phoenix's wings off. Oh, it's on. It is on now. Ah, yeah, the Vega is splish. My laser defense is only present on my naval forces. Come on, get it. Get that speedy bugger. EMP missiles, great for taking out shields. Since they're equipped with infrared seekers as well, and shields are a heat source. How's the Brigantia holding up? Ah, it's fine. It's all fine. We have enough smoke for days. I should probably make a pot joke here. Don't do drugs, kids. Hey, where are those missiles going? Oh, following the decoys. Okay, since you turned around, the Vega is not in any danger of being declared sinking and damaged. So I will now deploy an OP unit, the Moray. There go the missiles. Oh, you're turning around. Interesting. That means I can probably deal with you later. Or are you going to crush against the rocks here, this little island? Yep, the Moray's missiles have hit their target. However, the lag is getting a little bit annoying. And it just keeps increasing because now we have collision damage. But yeah, looks like the Angstrom has just lost a good portion of its hydrofoils. And its bottom hull plating. It has not enough speed and lift to keep itself afloat, which means the lasers are useless underwater, and you are now torpedo bait. Very nice. How's the damage on the Brigantia? Superficial. Looks like the smoke has worked fine. However, the Angstrom has been dealt with. This is what I want to see. Ooh. Raw injector engine power. Impressive. That is a chunk of power bar right there. But also a lot of fuel consumption. Oh, well, it's materials now, I guess. Okay, done and done. Next one, please. Okay. Okay then, here we go. Task Force Jupiter plus a Lionfish Microsub versus a Fuse and an Ampere. that is quite funny because you know that the fuses blow out if you put too much Ampere through them. Yeah, I know. Okay. Let's get on with it. Electrician joke. Hey. Okay. Yes. Targets. Targets. I need targets. Where are my targets? I see nothing but a clear sky full of stars. Oh, there we go. The first target is the Fulgrite installation. This is a resource harvesting installation that the lightning hoods can deploy in resource zones. It's armed with missiles and missile decoys, but other than that, it's quite harmless. And this sweeping beam of red light, by the way, is well, the other lasers from the lionfish microsub struggling to acquire a target, since the lionfish cannot pick up the full droid just yet. It sometimes needs to rely on other units to do, and other units' detection systems. Yeah, there we go. Missile interception successful. I'm glad that these systems all work together. Actually, I could deploy the Decanus class from my loud steam engine. Very loud steam engine. Okay then. Is the Fulgrite dead yet? No, it isn't. Has the lionfish finally acquired a target? Apparently not. Strange. Strange, strange, strange. Anyway, looks like this is it for the Fulgrite. Judging from the lack of incoming fire, it seems that the AI has been taken out. So next up should be either the fuse or... Oh, there we go. Smoke. Why are you smoking up? Oh, wait. Have you been hit by the targeting lasers of the lionfish? This could have triggered the smoke dispensers. Oh well. So, next up is noisy steam engine. The Ampere. A continuous laser mounted in the bow. And what looks like a Gatling version of a short-range laser. Apparently, many misses on my part. Oh, incoming torpedoes from the Decanus class. And missiles. And that's it for the Ampere, I guess. You're making an inviting target for the Brigantia battlecruiser. Or maybe not. Stop moving around so much. Oh, there we go. Yeah, I guess that's it. The EMP that just surged through there should have taken out some critical components. And the EMP should be done with in just a second. Okay. Well, I originally wanted to... continue using the Lionfish class microsub, but it seems that since it cannot acquire any targets above the water surface, I might have to scrap it, which is unfortunate. Although this should be able to be remedied by using Radar Boys. I'll see what I can do. Dear Le Cogula, I'll see what I can do to this Lionfish microsub to fix it, basically. Okay, and... Whoa, wait. So this is the fuse. Uh-huh. You know what? I don't know if you guys know this one, but this unit reminds me of a bomber that is can be seen in the game called Zero K. Very interesting. It does have this twin hull design as well, and forward swept wings, if I recall correctly. It looks very much like this one. I don't recall the name of this unit, though. Anyway, let's see what you can do. Oh, missiles. And... adaptable S-foils. Impressive. Though, oh, you're still airborne. Never mind that. I guess something more potent and precise be used against units such as this one. Maybe lasers, although missiles hitting it quite nicely. Yeah, lasers would be quite a kind of useful here. Still, the missiles from the Brigantia have done their job. The fuse has been destroyed. And pull all.
Receiving. Moving
and
now.
Oh yeah,
now.
Actually the lionfish can collect some of the
moving
scrap
now.
Lying
moving
around
now.
Here.
Moving now.
All right, then, onward. There's a resource zone that I like to capture.
Moving now. Receiving.
And
moving now.
Get me some more resources.
Moving now.
The carrier always trailing behind and providing support for my units, especially since it's a good material storage and it has repair capabilities as well. And how are you doing? Oh, you are doing just fine. Still capturing here. And oh yeah, you see the Twin Guard and the Seal Striders are making, well, great advances into Lightning Hood's territory. And before they all capture this here and this, I try to close them, I try to close off any gaps here so that they cannot reach further into Lightning Hood's territory. This is basically the same tactic I deployed against, or I used against the White Flayers. Well, you know, when I was capturing Steel Strider territory in the previous run of Quest for Nita. Oh, actually. You know what?
Listening. Moving
Do
out.
Not start capturing just
Listening.
Yet.
Moving out. Listening.
Intercept.
Listening.
And engage these ones first. Okay. Actually, cancel battle.
Listening. Moving out. Moving out.
Let's see, until you're in range, then I will engage the Eclipse as well as the current.
Listening.
At the same time. There we go. So, that I'm able to deal with two annoyances at once, I will destroy the cargo aircraft, as well as a damaged combat unit that could potentially capture some territory while I'm busy dealing with the, what's it called? The Lightning Hood's headquarters. Alright then, here we go. And all weapon systems online. Okay, who dares fire a laser at my units? No one? Oh well. Yep, there we have. Just pause there for a second. I would like to. I always like to show off the enemy units that I'm fighting currently. This is the current. Well, I would say. Kind of thruster craft with vectored thrust on these four engine pylons. Let's see how you do against my air force supported by an airship that also has torpedoes. You know, these air-to-air torpedoes. Apparently not so well. And if you're wondering what the hell happened to the Eclipse, I think this one despawned quite early on.
Listening. Moving
due to
out.
Being too damaged.
Listening.
Yeah,
moving
get
out.
Me that.
Moving out.
And then continue capturing.
Listening.
Oh, and I should
Listening.
Probably get some radar satellites
moving
in
moving
here
out.
As well. Once again, it is time to, well, send a new ship to the front lines. This is the Arcrux heavy cruiser, armed with rail-assisted HESH cannons, a combined anti-aircraft and Seabiss, well, APS gun, some missile decoys, anti-aircraft armament, torpedoes, and LMs. Yeah, and some smoke dispensers as well. Not much, but it'll have to do. For now. Well, at least until I can afford some heavier ships. Oh, and by the way, it does have a bat as its little figurine here. Because why not? Once more, we have incoming Lightning Hoods units. But this time, it is a megawatt. And I will now deploy... Well, I won't deploy the Battlecruiser Brigantia just yet. I will, however, deploy some other units. Let them have a little bit of battle time as well. Okay, here we go. Noisy steam engines. Onward. So this is a megabot. A lot of lasers and torpedoes, apparently. Let's see how my units deal with this one. Cramp cannons already being intercepted. And there is the Decanus class making its run. Yep, torpedo! Good hit. Good hit as well. I should probably mention that those light cruisers, the Apollo and the... Oh, wait. What just happened? Oh, the Apollo and the Scorpio do not have any smoke dispensers. So sending them against Lightning Hoods, which are primarily armed with lasers, might not be the most prudent courses of action. However, it is what it is. And this one is done. Well, doesn't fire anymore, so I assume it is done. Destroyed. Pack from the Decanus class. And here come a few torpedoes. Yeah, that's basically it. The innards have been, well, put through a blender, so to speak, by the hash rounds fired from those light cruisers. And I have taken negligible amounts of damage. At least my forces have taken negligible amount of damage. Battle finished! Nice! And you know what's also nice? I have finally captured the last terrain tile next to the headquarters of the Lightning Hoods. Which means I can go even further and maybe, possibly... No wait, you should not capture. Just move in there. Possibly...
Moving out.
Yeah, I can destroy the headquarters now. I originally planned to wait for the Arkrux heavy cruiser to join the battle, but I think an airship is faster.
Moving out.
Therefore, wait.
Moving out.
Yep, there we go. I would like you to introduce you to the Magellan Aero Frigate. An airship which I have been using in the Great Talon campaign, which is in German, armed with hash cannon, rapid firing frag cannon, some casemates as secondaries, mounted here under these, let's call them wings, another double barreled APS cannon firing primarily hash, and no wait, that one is firing heat. And particle accelerator cannons, the long-range version, side-mounted here. These are primarily meant to engage targets at similar altitude, as this particular pack lens does not have this wide field of fire that the other lenses have. So, oh yeah, I missile silos. I did not forget the missile silos. And a few missiles in the bow as well. So yeah, another airship. And as you can see, it is finally time to deploy some of my airships as well. I do wonder if I can make a dedicated airship group already. I probably can. Here we go. Deploying the light carrier Polaris and the Magellan Aero Frigate, as well as two torpedo boats, but in the air. It's different this time. Okay, there's the Magellan. And the Decanus class, Vega, Polaris. I like this lineup. Let's go! Lightning Hood's headquarters. You are about to be scrapped. Noisy steam engine. Alright then. Yeah, descending. And okay, your flight pattern is stable now. And there are the air-to-air torpedoes, sometimes used against ground targets. Those were originally designed to be used against Grey Talon airships, and they are quite effective at what they do, delivering a knockout punch. But they can be occasionally be used against ground targets as well. So that's the little resource harvester done. Who's next? Is everything all right? My forces do look good. Okay, next up should be the Quartzstone Fortress. And did you see those visual, those visual effects that they have added to From the Depths? We now have, well, we finally now have contrails made by jet engines. An addition which may not be that obvious or that important, but nevertheless one that I very much appreciate. Whoop. Yeah, those little lag spikes, they are annoying to say the least. Anyway, almost all guns are trained on this ammo factory. There's the particle accelerator cannon giving off a shot. Yeah, nice one. And the vector fighters coming in as well from the Polaris carrier. My other carrier, which I have mentioned earlier, is almost ready to be deployed. I think this is the next unit I'm going to build to basically form the basis for my next force. Oh wait, no, the carrier will be a force on its own, but it will support the next force I'm going to construct. And this one will lead the campaign against the Onyx Watch. Yep, this is the next enemy I plan to engage. So, have you defeated this Ouroboros munitions factory? No, apparently not. Nicely built, by the way. Very sci-fi looking. And green. So, how are my units doing? Still circling the enemy. They should be good on fuel, materials, but yeah, should be alright. Now, I could probably deploy another unit right now. I could deploy the Murray, this devious, terrifyingly efficient little ship. But Magellan Frigate has lost control? I don't think so. You're still active and alive. And very much flying as well. So yeah, what would be best? Since I assume the Quartzstone Fortress, the Lightning Hood's headquarters, is up next to be spawned. Yeah, boy, you have released your torpedoes too late. That's materials wasted. Oh! No! Do not adjust your video settings. The screen has frozen, even for me. It appears that the Quartzstone Fortress is about to spawn. And there we go. Wait. Before we blow it to pieces, let's take a moment to appreciate this Lightning Hood's headquarters, equipped with the newest hover technology, so that these missile turrets can float in the air. Yeah, and a large laser here on top of this spire. Yeah, nice headquarters actually, and this is an old unit here that seems to be under construction. I think it was called the Beluga. It was some kind of a laser-armed aircraft. It's no longer in the game, of course. Anyway, continue. Oh, not my vector fighters. They were... Well, I was about to say expensive, but they were not. They are very much disposable. And quite effective with particle accelerator cannons. Not against large units or heavily armored ones, but they can almost certainly one-shot most smaller aircraft. Oh yeah, that laser is getting annoying. I need... another airship. Let's see if my forces can take out this laser tower very early. Oh no, that doesn't look good. That doesn't look good indeed. One vector is... well, has its wings clipped a little bit. And my airship is still holding up just fine. And here come the torpedoes. Stopped by a metal beam. Ah. Looks like this rotating laser tower has been sufficiently damaged to the point where it can no longer reliably engage any of my units. And I'm going to pull the Decanus class for now. Not because it is ineffective, mind you, but this loud steam engine is a little bit annoying. Yeah, the Magellan, still airborne. Didn't took that much damage, and the fortress is getting destroyed at a rather reasonable pace. There we go, one missile turret down. Oh, that one was fatal, I think. This should have knocked out this laser tower. Yeah, you can see the EMP surging through the structure here. Yep. This is a visual bug, by the way. The laser has been knocked out. Yep, very much so. So then, no more disco for you. Disco is now officially dead. And I think I'll get the big guns in here. Or maybe not. How about... No? Okay. Guess I'll have to settle with a Moonray then. So, while my airships circle around the headquarters and are being supported by the Vector fighters launched from my Polaris carrier, it looks like the fight is about to end. The Quartzstone Fortress has taken a lot of damage. Quite a lot, in fact. And it's having... It has... Yep, I think it's despawning right now. This is it. the Quartzstone Fortress is despawning. Finally. And I believe, yeah, judging from the lack of incoming fire, once again, its AI has been taken out. This means I get more resources, so I don't have to, well, you know, destroy it. I'm not going to capture it, by the way. I just mean that if I have to destroy this headquarters, that means that fewer resources will be added to the scrap pool. Ah, Lightning Hoods, base of productions, defeated. Now all that's left to do is capture the remaining Tarantiles and hopefully cut off the Steel Striders, which are, well, expanding quite quickly, and cut off the Twin Guard as well. And then we will turn our attention towards the Onyx Watch. But first, there is still some work left to be done, as I believe that there are some Lightning Hood settlements that need to be redacted from the map. Yeah, destroyed basically. And some resource zones as well. I need to claim those resource zones for myself. And there we go, under new management. Hello, I'm your new boss. Please call me Steve. Corporate mergers come in many forms. Ah, yes. No more lasers for you. So, that's it. The Lightning Hoods have been almost completely eliminated. Yeah.
Listening. Moving out.
All that it's left to do now, all that's left to do now is to basically capture these territories here, cut off the Steel Striders from Lightning Hood's territory, and get what I can from here, if the Steel Striders are not capturing it, and then destroy these Lightning Hood's positions that are still remaining. So, and there's a resource zone as well. This is going to be mine. Anyway, with that being said, I hope you have enjoyed this episode of the Quest for Nita in From the Depths. I am Der Heizmeister, and I hope I'll see you next time on the Azure Seas of Nita, when we will be taking out a few Lightning Hood encampments. Take care, and goodbye.